And let's just say confidence is a great thing. But I love to see leaders have confidence that they can figure things out. I don't like it when they're confident that they already know. Already knowing is a death knell.
This is the ERP Organizational Change Journal podcast, brought to you by Nestell and Associates, a Newport Beach, California-based ERP organizational change management firm serving the private equity industry. The ERP OCJ seeks to share expertise, insight, experience, and research, and to create effective conversation to help guide ERP organizational change to real, measurable, and verified success. And now, here's your co-host, Jonathan Donald, founder of the change management firm Invert Ventures, and your ERP expert and host, the founder of Nestell & Associates, Dr. Jack Nestell.
On today's episode, we discuss private equity, leading through M&A and ERP disruption with Dr. Constance Dierickx. This episode will further examine high-stakes private equity leadership, leading through M&A change, and managing ERP disruption. Dr. Constance Dierickx is author, speaker, Harvard Business Review, and Forbes contributor, and the president of CD Consulting Group. Constance is the author of High Stakes Leadership, Leading Through Crisis with Courage, Judgment, and Fortitude. Her first book published in September 2017. Her follow-up book is The Merger Mindset, How Leaders Get Value from Mergers, Acquisitions, and Divestitures. And this was co-authored by Dr. Linda Henman and Taylor and Francis. Jack, I'm excited to have Constance on the show today.
Thanks for the intro, Jonathan. Likewise, I'm very excited for this interview. So let's dive in. Before Constance launched her successful practice, she, to use her own words, observed firsthand the power of emotion and perception distortion on major decisions. Her curiosity about the behavior of clients and colleagues led her to study psychology in business and earn a Ph.D. in clinical psychology, focusing on crisis intervention with individuals and organizations. So let's explore this idea more, and let's explore this idea of the intersection of business, psychology, leadership, and business disruption. We are looking forward to discussing leadership with Constance as it pertains to private equity, M&A disruption in general, and ERP organizational change disruption specifically. One thing is for certain, the stakes are high in mergers and acquisitions. Joining us from Atlanta, Georgia, Constance, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Jack. I'm delighted to be here with you and Jonathan.
We're looking forward. We're so excited to have you and share your insight with our listeners.
Great.
Absolutely. Constance, let's get started. So please tell us more and further introduce yourself to our listeners. What's behind the intro?
So many moons ago, I was a stockbroker at a large brokerage firm that shall remain unnameless, and I absolutely hated my job. It was a really tough environment for a woman. It was okay to be a sales assistant or, you know, an admin, but being a broker was not a common thing. So it was very challenging in that regard, but I found that I really enjoyed my clients. I loved helping people think about what they wanted to have their futures look like and how they needed to provide from a financial perspective for that. But of course, money is never just money. There's always emotion and context. For example, family traditions and habits play a role. And I got very, very confused when I had smart, successful clients who made stupid money decisions, and they insisted that they were right, and they were being irrational and not paying attention to the facts. Now, this is according to me, right? This was my version. And so because I hated my job, whenever I didn't have an appointment with a client, not whenever, but often I would leave the office and go down the street to a bookstore and try to find books that would help me explain this dichotomy. Like, how does the smart person who's 65 years old and has $2 million want to trade uncovered options? What the heck is that about? Et cetera, et cetera. So I ended up in the bookstore in the decision science section because I thought, aha, this is about decisions. And then I went, oh, it's not all that. So then I would go to the psych books And a lot of them were self-help, and that's not what I was looking for. But I finally found some things that made sense to me, and I was going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And I remember thinking, why doesn't somebody put this together? Well, I didn't know at the time that Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky were in Israel in their academic jobs doing the research that would become the foundation of behavioral economics. So that's been my obsession for the last 25 years or so. That's the behind-the-scenes story.
Constance, I love it. And I got themes of behavioral economics in your intro. And I'm so excited to see how that you take those themes in private equity.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that, Constance.
Sure.
Before we get started with the questions, I wanted to share some of my own work, as these are some of the areas and key notions that we'd like to discuss with Constance today. And one of the common denominators in my study of successful ERP organizational change, and actually specifically in the context of private equity, would suggest several consistent and prominent themes, which would include: all successful ERP organizational change projects experience significant challenges. Success not only varies with time, but can also improve more and more over time. Positive culture and behavior is important for ERP organizational change. Executive stakeholders are unaware of ERP and organizational change research. Promising practice organizations maintain persistence to success. And again, these are just kind of common influences over my work. And the value of reflection, lessons learned with each ERP organizational change experience, was a highly relevant influence. The absence of significant challenges is certainly not a precursor to ERP organizational change success. And lastly, organizations had a commonality in the definition and perspective of success. So in general, our conversation with Constance today will highlight some of these themes, which ultimately comes down to effective leadership in the context of significant business disruption. And I think the ideas and questions that we're going to discuss with Constance, I believe, will help promote these observations I just mentioned. So that being said, Constance, as leaders, it is critical to reflect and really understand that we can always learn, develop, and improve. And as mentioned earlier, a common theme in my work is that business leaders during successful ERP were highly reflective and determined to improve by taking advantage of lessons learned. And that said, you had an article that caught my attention. And as we'd mentioned in your intro, you seem to work between the art and science of behavioral science. And on your website, you ask, why smart people do stupid things. You state that the reason is that usually they have succumbed to the very human tendencies that they believe don't apply to them. Is this because of a lack of reflection and overconfidence?
Well, it can be multi-causal, but certainly a lack of reflection is a part of it. But honestly, reflecting with a closed mind is useless. And overconfidence is one of the things that closes our minds. I see it in leaders that they're not only overconfident. Now, and let's just say confidence is a great thing, but I love to see leaders have confidence that they can figure things out. I don't like it when they're confident that they already know.
Yeah.
Already knowing is a death knell. And sometimes you're lucky and it's not. But when overconfidence is also layered with what we call overgeneralizing, you're probably familiar with this. It's actually a term from developmental psychology where when children are learning to talk, a normal kid learning to talk will learn the form of a verb, and then they'll use that form of the verb. They haven't yet learned how to conjugate. Sure. So they're applying a word sometimes correctly and sometimes incorrectly. And, you know, some of your listeners are probably going to become irate that I'm talking about little kids, because after all, they're successful people and, you know, what's that have to do with them? The concept of generalizing applies. One of the things that makes me cringe, and it actually came up in a meeting this morning with a CFO who was talking about one of his board members. He's retired, but he's a very successful executive at a big company that you all would know the name of, and I'll leave that out as well. Well, when I was at fill in the blank, we did this. Right? You're laughing because you've heard it. This is a very common thing. The problem is the situation in front of you may have some similarities to the situation you faced 5 years ago or 10 years ago that you handled so beautifully, but there may be differences. So what I say to leaders is, because if I say this to them, they say, well, what do I do about that? I say, you need to be an explorer in your own territory. And one guy actually went out and got one of those safari hats. You know, like, it's like, I know, that was so hard for me to apply that if I put the hat on, I remember the conversation we had.
Interesting.
Because if you are an explorer in your own territory, and one of my clients does this by actually, this sounds so simple, but it helps him. When he goes to the office, at least 2 or 3 days a week, he goes in a different door. He sees different people. He talks to different people. It's the sort of anthropological expression of leadership. And leaders that think it's too cutesy or too techniquey to do it, you know, because they already know, that's, I worry about them.
So then just a follow-up to that, Constance, you mentioned a couple of great quotes, and one is reflecting with a closed mind is useless. Mm-hmm. And that's interesting. So my next question would be, how do you get outside of that? You know, and then you'd mentioned be an explorer in your own territory. And then with some very, I would say, tactical or practical examples. And one is, you know, using that different door or putting on that explorer hat would be just triggers to make you say, hey, yeah, well, reflection is one thing, but I need to start thinking about being more of an explorer, you know. But I've never really thought about reflection being in having a closed mind. I often thought about when I sit down and I reflect that I'm actually just naturally doing that with an open mind. But that's a great point.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, reflection can be an input that takes you nowhere.
Yeah.
Sort of like a check the box kind of thing. Yes, I did a postmortem on my whatever thing that we just did, but it's very mechanical or transactional.
Yeah, right.
That's not where you're going to learn the most. Where you're going to learn the most is to reflect and then ask other people to reflect. Maybe you're not doing it at the same time. You don't have to be in the same room. And maybe you are, but you begin to prompt one another. And so there's two things. One, you can learn what other people think. But the really important thing is you can, if you're open-minded, you can change your mind. That is valuable introspection. If introspection can become rationalization. And, you know, I was a therapist while I was a graduate student, and I saw lots of that, you know. Well, I do this thing and I don't like it, but I can't help it because, you know, my husband's this or my wife's that or my kids are horrible or whatever. That is not useful. That's actually kind of a patting yourself on the back for doing nothing.
Great insight. That's great.
Constance, I think we're going to get a ton of insightful quotes in this podcast today, and I'm really excited for them. So to be an explorer in your own territory leads me into our next question. In the world of organizational change and transformational change, mm-hmm. leaders have a different set of requirements in my experience. Yes, they need to have knowledge. Yes, motivation. Yes, understanding the organization and what's required for success. But knowledge and cognitive skill alone isn't enough. If leaders aren't walking their own talk, what happens to a transformation? And so you published an article in Forbes on how leaders can avoid the insidious knowledge trap.
Oh,
love
you saw
this.
That, did you? Okay.
Oh, well, I'm a big fan of behavioral economics, so I'm going to quote a paragraph here.
Oh, dear. Okay.
I promise I'll do it justice as best I can. Despite the rapidly expanding literature in behavioral economics and mm-hmm. the popularity of some of its well-known concepts, mm-hmm. it's surprisingly tricky to put conclusions from research into practical use.
Yeah.
As the behavioral economics theorists suggest, this challenge exists because decisions involve more than just knowledge and rational thoughts. Interpersonal and cultural context and emotions play a role, though mm-hmm. it's difficult for some to accept. So, Constance, tell us more about how this all fits and how leaders can learn to take this tricky concept and put it into practice in their lives.
That's a big question, Jonathan. Tell us more. One of the things that I notice that some people do consultants, advisors, is they have an interest in something from science. Let me take neuroscience, for example. I sit in presentations all the time where there's a presenter and there's the inevitable slide with a picture of a brain, and you know, like a drawing, a graphic of a brain. And they talk about the right brain and the left brain. And I just sit there and I'm like, you have no idea what you're talking about. Like within 5 seconds, it's like anybody with an understanding knows you don't know what you're talking about. But what they do is, I like to say, here's another phrase, they turn science into a jingle and they think it's cute. And it's not, it's foolish. So when we're talking about organizational change, there are a lot of methodologies, you know, consultants show up and say, I have a blueprint, I have a roadmap. And it's like, and you know, really, you don't even know anything yet. How did you draw a map for this client when you just showed up? Like you could have a conceptual model, that's fine, but the map has to be co-created and the map is not the territory. What exactly. I mean by that is you can stare at maps of Italy your whole life. You can watch every documentary you can find, including the very fine one done by Stanley Tucci and others, but it's not the same as going to Rome and Milan and Lake Como. And so leaders sometimes are too distant. They use a roadmap or they listen to a consultant's jingle and they feel smarter briefly. But what they miss is connecting with the people that are the territory. The map is the blueprint. It can be a good conceptual plan, but the leader has to be able to be influenced by what they learn through connecting with people who are doing the work to make it happen, and also helping them feel connected to the larger project. You know, why are we doing this? What does it mean? Why are you important here? And unfortunately, leaders can sometimes sit in their office too much and be disconnected from that. And I think especially when they're financial buyers and they're very interested, and financial buyers are fine. That's what they're there to do. But it's easier for them to sort of operate by remote control. But usually the financial buyer has management that should not be acting like they're the financial buyer. They should be acting like managers.
Very interesting. Constance, I want to share another blog with our listeners. And Jonathan, I appreciate your work. And by the way, for our listeners, we'll have links to any references to literature or podcast in our show notes. But Constance, you had a blog that caught my attention and, and I enjoyed it as well. But it was called Why Leaders Don't Listen and What They Can Do About It. And it actually, it kind of relates back, I think, to a little bit to the first couple of questions, I think, here. But you share that, quote, a barrier even for smart leaders is thinking that they are better listeners than they are, end quote. But then you add, quote, a leader who possesses confidence of this sort has no need to be the smartest, most knowledgeable person in the room because they trust themselves to learn and to adapt to new information.
Yes.
Can you dive into that a little bit more?
Yes. It's so ironic that you're mentioning this because I was talking about this with a leader today. He's brand new to his organization. Now, this guy happens to be a good leader and a good and a good observer, but a lot of times I find that leaders get surprised by surveys. Like I know Dan Dennison is involved in your company, and Dan's company that does the Dennison Culture Survey is a favorite of mine. It's the only culture survey I use because it's the only one worth using. And there tends to always be, at least in my clients, now maybe Dan would say it's not true for the baseline, but there's often lower scores in communication. And so what do leaders do? They call their communications team and they amp up the frequency, they alter the length, you know, they do videos, they do all these things because they've said that they interpret communicating as talking, conveying information. But the circuit of communication isn't complete until people hear and until the leader hears. So I find that leaders are they often overestimate their listening because they've kind of lumped it in this bucket of communication, and also because they believe that if anyone wants to talk to them, they can. I have an open door policy. Yeah, but you're the CEO, really?
Yeah.
Like, you got to realize that yeah. your role, forget about who you are. Your role has people see that in the context of their understanding. Like, what does that mean to them? No matter how nice a guy or a woman you are.
Yeah. Yeah, so true. And just for our listeners, Constance was referring to Dr. Daniel Dennison and the Dennison Consulting mm-hmm. in the Dennison survey. And we'll be sure to include that information as well.
Yeah, please do. It's the most, can I do a commercial?
Please do.
Sure.
It is the most researched culture survey on the planet.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there are not every segment on that survey has hefty validation behind it, but several of them do. And the benchmark that they compare to is marvelous. And I've used it in mergers and acquisition. I've used it in crisis. I've used it with a new leader. It's my go-to.
Absolutely. And I can tell you that Dr. Dennison is a friend, colleague, mentor, and class act. And so is his consulting company. And yeah, we also use his survey as well in our ERP organizational change efforts. So thank
for
you for that. Yeah. So Constance, let's switch gears a little bit. And I just want to talk a little bit about this idea of disruption. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you firsthand from 30 plus years of ERP organizational change practice that there's many disruptors that occur in every large scale ERP project, mm-hmm. Not to mention the fact that the ERP project itself is a huge business disruptor. Mm-hmm. And there are two themes from my own work that I mentioned previously, and I'll just quickly share that again. But that was that all successful ERP organizational change projects experience significant challenges. That's a truism. And that success not only varies with time, but can also improve more and more over time. And then thirdly, promising practice organizations, so those that have actually realized success and they agree that they've realized success, they maintain a persistence to success. And then lastly, the absence of significant challenges is certainly not a precursor to ERP organizational change, meaning, you know, the goal is not to prevent any and all issues, but it's to react properly and to adjust to issues when they do occur. And so, in other words, leadership appears to be able to effectively manage disruptors. In another blog, which again, I appreciated because it was speaking the truth, was how leaders can manage the disruptors and why they should. And in that, you said that disruptors rarely announce themselves. They come in several disguises. What's your thoughts on that and how leaders should manage disruptors?
So I guess before how to manage disruptors, I think that sometimes leaders can overdiagnose disruptors. I started using that phrase a few years ago when I said to a leader, I said, "You don't suffer fools gladly, do you?" And he was so flattered. He said, "Oh, yeah, that's so true." And I said, "Here's the problem. You overdiagnose fools."
Mm,
and that's the problem here. So disruptors can make a leader feel irritated because they're bringing things up. People who bring up problems aren't necessarily disruptors. A disruptor is somebody who has an agenda, an axe to grind, and they usually don't show up and say, "Hi, I'm here to push the train off the tracks."
Yeah, right.
What they do instead is they can be smarmy. They can precede many things that they say with, "Well, playing the devil's advocate here." Really? You know, if you're being the devil's advocate, you probably don't need to tell everybody that.
Yeah, right. Right.
You know, you could say something like, "I'm wondering about another way to look at this, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da." But the disruptors that trouble me the most, and these are usually very few people. It's a small number, but one organization I worked in, the CEO started calling them the insurgents.
Oh, geez.
Right? Dramatic. I mean, it gives you an image. And what they were doing was they were colluding and collaborating outside the company. And they had made up stories. They had their own mythology about what was happening and the motives of the CEO. And the way that we dealt with it was head on. This leader was very courageous. He got his board chair to come and visit the corporate office, and the two of them did an all-employee meeting, and they read aloud some of the anonymous messages that they were getting, because people were going to the board. They were going around the CEO. And the board chair just straight up called out lies and said that anyone that, and someone had asserted that they were recording phone calls, and the board chair was an attorney and a former attorney general. And he said, you know, I mean, he basically said, enough of this crap. But what the CEO did simultaneously in terms of dealing with people who were disrupting was every bit as important. What he was doing with the people that were cooperating, he was actively paying attention to people and what they were doing and giving people a lot of feedback, and a lot of it was positive. He promoted some people maybe a little bit early, you might say, because he wanted to signal, this is a place where there's opportunity. Now, the CEO, who I knew well, is an honest man. This was done with integrity. This was not like, I'm going to promote somebody for show.
Yeah.
And so I think when you're dealing with disruptors, you have to be direct with them. If they can be brought into alignment, fine and great. But if they can't, you just have to say, this isn't the right place for you. But it's equally important to be actively engaged with people that are helping, because, you know, if you spend all your time with the people that are kicking up the gravel, what does that say to other people?
It sounds like that's a both and solution, Constance.
That is the title of my next book.
Both and.
Is it really? That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm writing it now, yeah. So, you know. Who, you know how that goes, you know, publishers and editors. So I don't really like that. The whole premise of the book is that we get into trouble making decisions because we dichotomize. Mm. And why do we do that? Why do smart people dichotomize? Because it makes our lives simpler. And sometimes it's perfectly fine.
That's exactly right. Constance, when that book is released, please let us know so we can be sure to share that with our listeners.
Great.
And to read it.
Oh, that'd be good too.
Constance, going off the both and thinking, and when our heuristics lead us astray, you know, reflecting with a closed mind is useless. And that's a quote I'm going to take from this conversation. I hope I'm going to use this often. It makes me think of, I find, a famous quote by the physicist Richard Feynman.
Excuse me. I have to have a moment of worship.
Yeah. Okay. That's fine.
Yes. Love him.
You might have another one, because I'm going to use the Charlie Munger corollary of Feynman.
Okay.
Which is it's so much easier to fool oneself. Let's do Feynman first. You are the easiest to fool.
Yes.
Right. So we've got this piece, and then we've got the Charlie Munger piece, which is sometimes you don't realize that you're the one-legged person at an ass-kicking contest.
Yes.
And so we've got two things here, and I want to tie this to the psychology of self-reflection, that sometimes you're the easiest one to fool. Actually, you're always the easiest one to fool, and sometimes you can't see what you can't see. So.
Right.
When we're dealing with change and leadership, how can we learn to see what we don't see? And what are some indicators that might tell us that we're not seeing something?
Great question.
So there's two parts to my answer. The first is, how do you learn to see what you don't see? One way is to learn to pay attention to how you feel. You know, the word feelings is often thought of as descriptive of emotion. But what is emotion? Physiologically, let's say you get anxious. Let's say your heart rate goes up 20 beats. I don't know where I got that. but
I think you took that.
and you notice that your heart is beating faster, but you describe the feeling as being, maybe you say my heart is beating faster, which is a description of a physiological condition. But then you add to it, you know, I was nervous about this or anxious about that or worried that I would do this thing wrong or whatever. So feelings, if we take a feeling and we pay attention to it and we ask ourselves, where is that coming from? What is that about? With curiosity rather than denying it. Like, oh no, I never get mad. I never raise my voice. Really? I don't want to be friends with you. Because like, that's too limited a range for me. I need breadth.
I love that. Look at that.
It's just no fun, right? You know, I have friends that call me sometimes and they're almost yelling at me, but they're not yelling at me. It's like a righteous indignation moment. You know, they have strong feelings. So if you become aware of what you're feeling and then you ask yourself, what's happening? You know, like if you have a new symptom and you go to see your GP and they say, well, they should say, well, what changes have there been? You know, top one, new medication. Got a rash? Oh, really? You might be allergic to sulfa. So you tie things together and give yourself more information. My cynical answer to your question, how do you learn to see what you don't see? You can't. I mean, there's some things you're never going to see. I have a couple of blind spots that are hard for me. So here's what I do. I have really good friends that are consulting psychologists. They love me and they will tell me when I'm full of crap. And I call them and I say, da-da, you know, and then they go, Constance, it's, and I'm like, oh no, it's that again. And so that is why consultants like you, Jonathan, and Jack, and myself, I am often positioned inside a client in an advisory role. And people say to me, well, what do you do in M&A? Are you IT? Are you finance? I'm like, none of the above. Hmm. What do you do? And I go, I ride shotgun. I sit in the cockpit. This is a client said to me, you sit in the cockpit with me. You're looking at the same instruments I'm looking at. You're experiencing the same turbulence. You're looking through the same windshield. And somehow you and I don't see things the same.
That's
and
great.
That is why you're valuable to me. So I think we have to admit that we're not great at everything, and that's okay. But don't just say, oh, that's just me. I can't help it. I'm an extrovert. No, get help. You know, unless it doesn't matter. You know, if you don't like pistachio ice cream, fine, don't eat it. I don't care.
There's so much here I'm finding, Constance. I just want to take a moment before we go to the next question to highlight some of the things I'm hearing for our listeners.
Okay.
And the first is seeing what we don't see and realizing our blind spots isn't something we just do cognitively. We can tap into our body, into our emotions as another sensory tool to see what's going on.
Yes.
And that could be a whole nother conversation that I would love to.
Yeah, take it as a clue. Yeah.
And then, so that's on the individual level. And on a collective level, what can we do? And you mentioned this for M&A, you can invite some smart, wise people, both in fields that you're aware of and fields that are uncertain, and have them look at the same information and be curious about the conclusions they're coming to, because there's definitely scenarios where you won't be able to see it, even if with an open mind. And so appreciating those two things might give us a leg up.
Yes, absolutely.
Seeing what we don't see.
I will add to the get help. You need to get help from people who are not simply experts in some experience, but people who are good at observing process. That is not something everyone can do. Oh, I've done 18 M&As. Yeah, right. 16 of them failed. I mean, what does that tell us? Okay, let's look at the two that succeeded, but not overgeneralize and say we did these 18 things or these. I seem to like that number, don't I? We did these six things. You know, we hired this consulting firm to do change management. I'm using air quotes. But if you're not in a trusting relationship with your advisor and they aren't a good process observer, then it limits the value of that relationship. So a good process observer is somebody who can watch what's happening and feed back to you. So one of my clients says, you tell me what's really going on. I'm like, well, that's kind of what I'm supposed to do, I think. It was like he thought that was a revelation. I was like, no, that's so observing and sometimes not judging at all.
Constance, your book, The Merger Mindset, helps leaders learn how to adapt and manage, as you state, the powerful undercurrents and interpersonal dynamics at play in the high stakes realm of deals, end quotes. And you discuss how there's an appropriate mindset, air quotes, that leaders must have for effective decision making. And I'm going to refer your listeners to your great book for the details. But in general, what does that appropriate mindset look like? Can you maybe share a little more with our listeners?
Yes. Actually, the appropriate mindset is a non-transactional, non-mechanical way of looking. So it's holistic, it's integrative, it's synthetic. You know, something happening over here in your organization can affect something in another place. It can certainly affect your customers. And so the leader, top leadership team can share this. They have a responsibility to paying attention to the whole and not get bogged down in staring at spreadsheets. You know, one of my phrases is, if you're staring at spreadsheets, you might not know the tide's coming until your feet are wet. That's too late. You know, your chair is now stuck in wet sand. And now you're mad and you probably spilled your beer. So it's a bad scene. And the other thing leaders have to do is they have to have a mindset around connecting. And this concept of connecting is something that has come upon me more in the last year or so, that a leader has to help people connect to the purpose of the organization, the vision, the reason for the deal. If we're talking about a merger or an acquisition, you know, mostly they're acquisitions. Let's just tell the truth here, disguised as, you know, dressed up as. And so people have to understand that they play an important role and that it's meaningful that they're there and that they are meaningful. Absent that, people leave. Whether you're in a deal or not, people will leave. Sooner or later, they will leave. And your good ones will go too, especially your good ones. So you don't want that.
Fantastic. And I think there's so much insight here. Constance, I spent a lot of time thinking about this question, so I'd love to get your thoughts.
Okay.
Why are some leaders successful in ambiguity? And I think you might use the word crisis. Mm-hmm. Why others aren't able to lead? What do they do differently? And I'm really curious on a four quadrant perspective. So what do they believe? How do they behave? What systems may they use? And how do they show up in relation to people?
Okay.
And what can we learn from them to be more successful leaders ourselves?
Okay. So learner's mindset and explorer's mindset, behaviors that match what the message is. So alignment, systems that don't interfere with the organizational objective, and a culture of psychological safety. I think that out of all of these, the number one thing is the leader's behavior. It doesn't matter what they say. People don't listen to what leaders say, but they will definitely detect a distinction between what they say and what they do. Yeah. And then the cynicism will grow. And now you're eroding your culture. People will ignore the systems.
Mindset doesn't matter.
So I went backwards around the grid.
Yeah. So Constance, one thing I do when I'm being a contrarian is I ask to have a new KPI. And it's called leadership modeling. And it's how the rest of the organization views that leader as adhering to the values they're trying to do. So it's that very statement.
That should always be part of any, not just a change effort, but everyday business. Like if the leader, you know, if someone wants to meet with me, a CEO wants to meet with me, and they want help with their team, but they think it's all those other people, and they don't want to be, you know, one CEO said to me, "Oh, I want you to work with my team, but I don't have to be there." Really? No. He goes, "No, they need time away from me." And I'm like, and all I could think of was like, dude, I am so not working with you. Like, bye-bye. See ya. Yeah. And I told him, I said, "That's ineffective. Here's why. But you will find a consultant that will do that. But I caution you against doing that," because the leader wasn't holding himself accountable for exactly what you're saying, Jonathan, to behave in a way that matched the values and the behaviors that are needed to achieve the objectives.
So Constance, often during a private equity ERP organizational change endeavor, there are many organizational influences that are often invisible and abstract and difficult to measure, right? And in fact, that's exactly why we use the Denison survey, is to take something that's very abstract and hard to see and measure and put it into a form that can create useful and productive conversation, right?
And, yes, and that's absolutely,
that's where the Denison survey comes in for us. And the great work of Dr. Denison and his team is incredibly valuable in that regards. But on your website, you discuss making the invisible visible. Constance, you state that quote, or I should say your website states that quote, Constance works with senior executives to enable decisions about matters when the best data is qualitative and behavioral. That is so true in my view. Can you explain more? Maybe just dig a little bit deeper into that.
Yeah. So oftentimes leaders struggle with productively and accurately using observational data. So that just means I saw people doing something. And because leaders, just like all the rest of us, I do this, you guys probably do this, is you see somebody doing something and you tell yourself a story about why they're doing it, especially if they irritate you. You know, we go to diagnosis land. And I joke with my clients and I say, you know, we're not going to psychoanalyze anyone. I know how, but I'm the only one here that does. So let's take that off the table. Because people will say things like, she's lazy, or he has no sense of accountability, or, and they just slap a label on it, gets repeated, and then the person is in a box. Now, the person may not even know they're in a box. But rather than say, you know, here's my diagnosis, if a leader says to someone, you know, every time we have a senior team meeting, you are so quiet that it's hard for your colleagues to get a sense of who you are. And because they don't know, they're inserting their own version of their own story about who you are and why you're so quiet. I know you want to be promoted to executive vice president, but it's going to be hard for me to help you do that if your peers don't realize what a great contribution you make, because you make it all behind the scenes. Now, that's a very positive conversation. But rather than just a CEO saying to somebody, I can't promote you because you have no executive presence. Like, I don't even know what the hell that means. You're like, what is that? Yeah. You know, or this guy in my meeting this morning used EQ like six times. I finally said, can I stop you and ask you, like, which part of EQ are you tagging? Like, what's most memorable? He doesn't know. It's just a label. It's
buzzword.
Like, it's the jingle. Yeah. It's the jingle. It's like, there was some research, not by Daniel Goleman, by the way. Daniel Goleman popularized it. Good for him. Yeah. Smart move. But there's the research and it becomes a jingle and everybody walks around singing the jingle and assuming that we have shared meaning when we don't. But I think being more descriptive with your observational data is the way to go. Stay away from judging it until you know more. You know, if you find out somebody really is lazy, schleppy, and not accountable, fine, fire them.
Constance, I have a saying that's rather similar.
Okay.
Making the covert overt.
Yeah.
So invisible, visible, there's a lot there that really resonates for me.
Yeah.
Especially those stories or ego stories that come up that we may not be able to see. So.
And that's why people need us. Because, you know, it's the stranger in a strange land who shows up. I don't know if you read Heinlein, but the stranger in the strange land comes in and sees things that people that have been living there don't see. That's normal. That doesn't mean anybody's dumb or irresponsible. It's just a fact that we habituate. And this is very psychological. We habituate. Do you hear that buzzing sound? What buzzing sound? Oh, that? Oh, yeah, that fan's been doing that for 8 years. That's the mechanical electronic version of what we're talking about.
I think that's brilliant. Constance, this is probably tied for my favorite question to ask in general, and I'm pretty sure this will be my favorite question of this interview. So Jack and I absolutely love learning from our colleagues, friends, researchers, people who have boots on the ground. If you're thinking about all the people in ERP organizational change and transformational change projects, if they could listen to this conversation, what would you advise them to do? And I want you to phrase it in what would you ask them to look for? What would you ask them to do behaviorally? And how would you ask them to show up? in order to create success for themselves, their projects, and the companies they serve?
I'm going to start with how I would tell them to show up. Show up as a curious, non-know-it-all. That's not a phrase. That's a terrible phrase. don't kick in the door with your gun drawn, you know, like you know where the target is, because you don't. I think showing up as a relaxed explorer, curious-minded person that's easy to talk to invites a lot of conversation, which leads to a lot of learning. So that's the first thing I would say. I would tell people to look for what's great. Look for what's really, really good. When I ask people, tell me what's really great about you, they really almost always have a hard time with that question. That makes me sad. Like, you don't know what's really great about you? Wow, that's what we need to build on. Let's think about that. Sometimes I have to fill it in for them. So look for what's really great, look for what's working, and look for why it's working and who's involved so that you can repeat that. Look for the impediments, like who are the disruptors, who are the human speed bumps in a process, and move them out. You know, give them a little time to sort of get with the program. But I've never, ever, 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 ever had a leader say to me, oh, I wish I'd waited longer to fire that person. No one ever says that. They say, why did I wait so long? And then what I would have them do to do, what would I have them do in a change? I would have them bring together a group of high potential, but not yet executive leaders. I'm saying it like I've never done this. This is what I do. Okay. Look for the high potential. Look for the kick ass going, you know, future rock star on their way to being a rock star. I don't care if they're a director, a senior man, whatever, but bring them together into a team of people that are going to help guide the change. Don't bring in busloads of consultants and tell them to manage the change. They can't do it. They may be smart as heck, but consultants are bad at doing the boots on the ground work. They're great at observing, riding shotgun, providing frameworks, ideas, and reflections. That's all marvelous stuff. Very helpful. But then you select this group of people, let's say, and the firm I used to be with, we did this at Best Buy, which is where I learned it. And my colleague, Elizabeth Gibson, was the team leader. We evaluated. Now, I was in a firm of consulting psychologists, so everyone has a Ph.D. in psychology, which is the credential that allows you to use that word to describe yourself. And we evaluated people, and we tossed some of them back. Go fish. Nope, nope, nope. And we had a set of criteria. We taught these very smart, energetic, God, they ran us ragged. We taught them about change, about behavior change. We taught them the Prochaska and DiClemente and the Fisher and Fisher models from basic science research. They got it. They understood it. Together, we developed the methodology for them to use. And then they hit the road and they went out across the company and helped to transform it. And in the process, several of them got huge promotions, huge, like jumping a couple job levels, because the leaders could see how good they were and how quickly they could learn something that they didn't really know and apply it in the best interest of the company. So what we did was everywhere these change team people went, 2 or 3 days a month, depending. Everywhere they went, we were glued to their side, and they would do the work. We didn't do the work. They did the work, and we gave them feedback at every opportunity throughout the day and usually over long dinners. And it was so much fun, and their careers just went nuts. And there's a book about it. It's called Big Change at Best Buy. This is pre-Hubert Joly, who is the recently retired CEO of Best Buy. This was a while ago, but the process still pertains.
Constance, thank you so much. I had such a great time, and I'm sure our listeners are going to find this really insightful. Listeners, you can find Dr. Constance Dierickx on our show notes, and we'll link to her website. And I hope you find this conversation as valuable as I have. Thank you all. Jack, Constance.
I want to say thank you to you, Jonathan, and you, Jack. This was really fun. You asked me very big questions, And then you brought them back to practical advice, which I think is the most valuable for your listener. So it was a real pleasure. And I have a lot of material now. You'll see it in my future articles.
That's great.
Feel free to tag.
Yeah.
Constance, thank you again. Be well. It was such a pleasure.
Thank you.
And
you too.
We'll talk soon.
Okay.
Take care.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us for today's episode of the ERP OCJ podcast. This podcast is intended as a forum to study, share, and discuss ERP organizational change successes and challenges. We discuss the people, process, and technological components of ERP organizational change by drawing on knowledge from extensive research, collaborative learning, and practitioner expertise and experience. We are incredibly grateful to have friends, colleagues, and mentors join us in our podcast as we seek to promote, connect, and foster relationships in the ERP organizational change community and contribute to its success by bringing research and practice closer together. We want to make sure this is the most useful and insightful ERP podcast you listen to, and we'd love your help in doing so by leaving us feedback and a review. A great place to do so is at Apple Podcasts. Just click on the Listen in Apple Podcasts link, then click Ratings and Reviews, and let us know your thoughts. You can get more info about the show, including show notes and episode highlights for this and all of our episodes, by visiting NestleandAssociates.com and clicking the podcast option. Please join us again next week as we discuss the latest ERP organizational change research, practice, and stories. And don't forget to follow us on social media, hashtag the ERP OCJ. Thanks again for listening. Have a fantastic week.